switch gears a little bit now and talk about a person who is leading the way in the field of medicine and specifically in the field of fetal surgery. The things that he does and his team at Children's Hospital in Philadelphia are no less than astonishing. He's Dr. Scott Adzik. He is Surgeon in Chief at Children's Hospital of Philadelphia. He is a specialist in fetal surgery, and that means working on children while they are in the womb. And appropriately enough, the title of his remarks today, A Womb with a View, Adventures in Fetal Surgery. Please welcome, it made me laugh too, Dr. Scott Adzik. Scott.
Thanks, Tyler.
Knock him down.
You. Good?
I just observed that despite the schedule change, Tyler picked the right guy for this talk because I am not La La Land, that's for sure. Imagine you're an expectant mother going in for your routine 18-week gestation ultrasound and you're excited. You want to know, is it a boy or is it a girl? Mostly you want to know, is the baby okay? Is the baby healthy? But then you find out that the baby has a serious life-threatening birth defect that may require fetal surgery. Thankfully, you are referred to our team at the Center for Fetal Diagnosis and Treatment at the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia, known as CHOP, where we provide comprehensive care for the mother carrying a baby with a birth defect. I'm a pediatric and fetal surgeon, and for me, this is a typical day at work. Some life-threatening birth defects require a big operation for the mother and for the fetus. Open fetal surgery requires a team, part of the team is shown here, and there are two patients, the appropriately selected sick fetus who has everything to benefit from the operation, and the mother, who's a healthy, medical, innocent bystander who has to assume some risk to help her unborn baby. This is my patient viewed through a tiny 2-millimeter fetoscope. The fetus is at 20 weeks gestation, where term is 40 weeks, so about halfway through. Here's the fetal leg. You can see the umbilical cord, the chest, the face, the hands, the arm. You can see the legs, the feet, the toes at 20 weeks gestation. And here's the placenta, which is the crucial nutritional hookup between the mother and the fetus. In the beginning, well, the work to make fetal surgery a clinical reality started 30 years ago. And here's a story told by me and some of my colleagues at CHOP.
For most of human history, the fetus has been really shrouded in mystery and multiple layers of the maternal abdomen obscuring anything that was wrong with the fetus.
With the emergence of prenatal diagnostic techniques, particularly with the advent of maternal fetal ultrasound, we could view into the womb for the first time.
We could see things we'd never seen before. And as those fetuses were followed, it became more clear what may or may not happen to them.
There were a certain category of birth defects that were, for the most part, lethal. Where when the baby was born, we were too late to do anything about it.
That was really the impetus to try to knock on the door sooner.
Perhaps we can treat this new group of highly selected unborn patients who have severe diseases that are progressive during the pregnancy. Maybe we could treat them before birth, and that was a very radical and controversial concept. Birth defects are a big problem medically. They are common. 1 in 28 babies is born with a structural birth defect. They're costly.
Billions of dollars are required for medical treatment. Birth defects are merciless. No parent is immune. They're mysterious. Most causes of birth defects are unknown, overlooked. Research, in my view, is underfunded. And they're deadly. Birth defects are the leading cause of infant mortality. Prenatal therapy requires prenatal diagnosis, whether it be pregnancy screening tests, the newest of which is NIPT for non-invasive prenatal testing, where you can glean fetal cells and fetal DNA from the maternal blood, from a single maternal blood sample for diagnosis. Sophisticated fetal imaging, high-resolution ultrasound, fetal MRI, you can do MRI, fetal MRI, and that's a technique that we helped develop at CHOP in the 90s. Molecular diagnostic techniques that largely sprang from the Human Genome Project, so to the point where most human anatomic and genetic abnormalities are now routinely diagnosed before birth. The Center for Fetal Diagnosis and Treatment at CHOP was founded in 1995 with the vision, the imagination, of being the world's premier center for maternal, fetal, and neonatal care and the leader in birth defect treatment, research, and education. This shows the unique Garbos Family Special Delivery Unit at CHOP, which is where we work. Prenatal diagnosis of the birth defect, pregnancy management, including possible fetal therapy, the special delivery of the baby with a birth defect so that we can bring all the layers and layers of expertise that CHOP has to offer to the baby and while keeping the mother and baby together in the same place. This is our benefactor and CHOP trustee, Lynn Garbos, with a mother and baby who many weeks before had undergone spina bifida surgery before birth. Families come from all over to our center at CHOP. During the past 22 years, more than 20,000 prenatal referrals from all 50 states and from more than 60 countries outside the U.S. What are some of the birth defects that we fix before birth? Well, here's the fetal hand at 22 weeks gestation. The baby at that gestational age is smaller than my hand. We're operating on the unborn baby's chest to remove a life-threatening lung tumor. The operation is done under deep maternal general anesthesia, which also anesthetizes the fetus. A sideways lower abdominal wound is made in the mother's abdomen to expose the uterus, and the uterus is opened using a specialized uterine stapling device that we invented. The otherwise fatal lung tumor, which is causing heart failure in the fetus, is removed. The baby's chest is then closed, the uterus is closed, the maternal abdomen is closed. The normal lung tissue, which has been squished, now has sufficient space to grow like gangbusters, with the baby still inside the mom. The heart failure resolves. The baby is born many weeks later and can breathe normally. This is Roberto, the first baby at CHOP to have a lung tumor removed before birth in 1996 at 22 weeks gestation. Here he is as a healthy 6-month-old. You can tell his father wants him to be a baseball player. 5 years of age, playing T-ball. 17 years of age, throwing out the opening pitch at a Philadelphia Phillies spring training game in Clearwater, Florida, just north of here. He's now a college sophomore on a baseball scholarship at the University of Texas. He wants to be a professional baseball player. Remarkable. We use fetoscopy for treatment of twin-twin transfusion syndrome, which is known as TTTS. The setup is, here's the uterus, identical twins, two separate amniotic sacs. There are abnormal blood vessels on the shared placenta. These twins have one placenta, the nutritional hookup with the mom, as opposed to the usual two. And there's a problem. One twin, because of these abnormal blood vessels on the placental surface, gets too much blood, develops heart failure, becomes swollen with fluid, develops an abundance of amniotic fluid. The other twin doesn't get enough blood from the mother, develops kidney failure, doesn't produce amniotic fluid, is known as a stuck twin because it becomes shrink-wrapped in its amniotic membranes, and both twins will go on to die. The way to treat this is to introduce a tiny fetoscope through the mother's abdominal wall, through the uterine wall, visualize the placenta, and then use a laser to perform photocoagulation to occlude the culprit blood vessels. Here are Aiden and Dylan, both saved before birth by fetoscopic laser therapy for twin-twin transfusion syndrome at 20 weeks gestation. Spina bifida is another condition we treat before birth. Spina bifida affects about 1,500 babies born in the United States each year. That translates to about 30 per week, 5 per day. And spina bifida repair before birth is one of the most common fetal surgery operations that we perform at CHOP. The fetus with spina bifida has two major problems. The first is shown here. Part of the spinal cord and the spinal nerves protrude through an opening in the back and are damaged progressively before birth because of exposure to the toxicity of amniotic fluid. Most of amniotic fluid is fetal urine, which leads to nerve damage and paralysis. These are children, when they're older, are frequently wheelchair-bound. The second problem is shown here. Cerebral spinal fluid bathes the brain and the spinal cord, and with spina bifida, it pours out through this opening in the back. This leads to herniation of the brain stem into the neck of the spinal canal, and that interferes with cerebral spinal fluid circulation. The fluid builds up in the brain, causes hydrocephalus and brain damage, and children who aren't treated before birth require a shunt tube to be placed to drain the fluid into the abdomen, which is required lifelong. In order to protect the delicate, developing, exposed spinal cord, the fetal spina bifida lesion is managed and repaired before birth. The uterus is opened. This is the view. This is the spina bifida. Closure of the various layers, including the final layer, which is the skin. Very delicate surgery. For the remainder of the pregnancy, this repair will save the unborn baby from more than 3 months of amniotic fluid ravaging the nervous system and should also mitigate hydrocephalus and brain damage. Meet Colin, Micah, and Sean. Each underwent fetal surgery to repair spina bifida at 22 to 24 weeks gestation back in 2001. Although fetal surgery is not a complete cure for spina bifida, look at them now displayed on my iPhone. I recorded this, so I'm proud of this. They're tossing the football around. No evident paralysis. No wheelchairs. No internal shunt tube draining excess fluid from the brain. Healthy kids. There is much more to be done, which requires research. One of my mentors at Harvard Medical School and when I trained at Boston Children's Hospital many years ago, Dr. Judah Folkman, taught me that as long as there is an unconquered disease, an injury that cannot be repaired, or a method of prevention that remains beyond reach, we have an obligation to conduct research. Research represents hope, and for many patients and families, hope is the best thing we have to offer. We pursue our investigations so that one day we can offer more than hope, we can offer health. So we're committed to research as a means to offering hope to the families we treat. Here are some of the next breakthroughs in fetal therapy based on research. My brilliant colleague at CHOP, Dr. Alan Flake, the Colquitt Professor of Pediatric Surgery, has been working for 3 decades in the laboratory to devise a treatment for the fetus with a whole variety of prenatally diagnosed cellular deficiency diseases, one of which is sickle cell anemia, by transplanting before birth healthy adult blood cell-forming stem cells, before birth. The immunologically immature fetus early in gestation does not reject these adult stem cells. The cells engraft in the bone marrow and take over the missing function. I predict that within the next year, Dr. Flake and his team will treat sickle cell anemia at 12 to 14 weeks gestation in this manner. Can you believe that a cure for sickle cell anemia is within our reach? We are also poised to make a big breakthrough for the tiniest patients who are born much too early. This highlights the problem of prematurity. Babies born at 23 weeks gestation here on the left face very tough odds, a 74% mortality rate, death rate, a 92% complication or morbidity rate, despite all the high technology medical things that we have at our fingertips. The outlook for babies born only 5 weeks later is much better, 8% mortality, 43% complication rate. We need a life-saving bridge to take premature babies from 23 weeks gestation to 28 weeks gestation. Dr. Flake and his team at CHOP have devised a life-saving bridge in animal models, a womb-like environment using an experimental fetal lamb model shown schematically here on the left. So follow me. A fetal lamb, way too premature to survive, is connected to a bypass circuit, a specialized one, which provides oxygen and nutrition, just like the placenta, with connection via the blood vessels that go into the umbilical cord. And the lamb is in a sterile, uterus-like biobag with amniotic fluid percolating through. And on the right, here is an actual fetal lamb in the artificial womb getting 4 weeks of support with normal growth and development. This neonatal intensive care unit of the future to support extremely premature babies will indeed be a brave new world. And here's that same lamb you just saw on the last slide, hopping around shortly after birth, 4 weeks later. The timeline for prenatal therapy is shown here beginning in the 80s. We had open fetal surgery developed in the 1980s, fetoscopic surgery for like twin-twin transfusion syndrome beginning in the 90s, fetal cellular therapy, which is developing just now with hematopoietic stem cell transplantation. I predict in the future we will have fetal gene therapy for single gene disorders and apply new technology in gene editing. So the role of fetal therapy is growing and growing. And this will include, in my view, the artificial womb, probably about 2 years away from clinical applications. I imagine that some of you have watched the PBS trilogy entitled Twice Born, Stories from the Special Delivery Unit, about the work we do for the Center for Fetal Diagnosis and Treatment at CHOP. The television miniseries, 3 one-hour episodes, aired on PBS recently and documented the lives of these 4 CHOP fetal surgery patients over the course of 15 months. We let the outside world in to see the wonderful world inside CHOP. Here's the trailer.
There was a huge amount of skepticism, huge. Because everybody says, oh, these guys are a little bit crazy. Gotta watch them, a little bit crazy. Half the audience is like this, Chris,
like this.
And the other half of the audience is their jaws down. And then you'd sort of walk off the stage thinking, well, maybe they're right, maybe we are crazy. But we weren't.
They just told me that it looked like there was a tumor coming out from the mouth, that my baby was gonna die.
Weakness and paralysis at the knees, ankles, and toes.
This is not part of our plan, like this couldn't be my baby you're talking about.
It's an incredibly unstable situation for the twins.
You're supposed to hear the heartbeat and see the babies moving, and everything was quiet.
We were nervous beyond imagination.
The diagnosis was fatal if there was no intervention.
Surgery on your baby while you are pregnant is a very, very big deal.
They're operating on the baby while she's still attached to me.
And this kid's coming out, but he needs to come out.
This can't be done many places in the world. This is not amateur hour. This is very serious stuff.
It's very important for the parents to know that there are no guarantees.
We're only going to be happy and victorious if it goes this way, but there's a possibility that it won't.
There are times where our hearts are broken. We carry every single heartbreak with us to every single case.
One of the things that we were trying our best to do was to allow ourselves mentally to go to the areas that made us afraid. You know, let's go to that for a moment that we might lose her. To ignore it as a possibility is naive.
We have all these patients and their child, they know even before they're born that there's something wrong with them. It doesn't matter.
He's here. Our baby's here. He made it.
We're driven by patient needs.
What's going on?
We're driven by trying to find solutions to those unsolved problems. It's a miracle and a privilege to take care of patients, particularly babies. Babies are the future, right? What could be more compelling than a baby? Gosh.
Twice Born won an Emmy last fall for Outstanding Science and Technology Programming, and Monica Lang and Bonnie Cutler were the co-directors. It's hard to believe it. We won an Emmy. I mean, come on. Each year we have a fetal family reunion for the Center for Fetal Diagnosis and Treatment, where we have a day of fun and celebration for the children. This is the first year back in 1996 where there were actually in the back row more healthcare professionals than there are patients. And also, I had brown hair. And here's the 20th fetal family reunion last year at CHOP. I would like to show some of our fetal patients briefly, and the theme is, look at me now.
Addison is everything a three-year-old little girl should be.
She has just got such a bright love of life, and if the Center for Fetal Diagnosis and Treatment was not there, or if we were not made aware of it, Addison would not be here today.
People that know her, they look at her and they can't believe it. And all you can do is you sit there and you say, just look at her now.
Look at me now. Look at me now. Look at me now. Look at me now. Look at me now. Look at me now. Look at me now. Hello.
Say, look at me now.
Hello.
Say hooray.
Yay. Look at me now.
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 See me now.
Look at me now.
Show me now.
Look at me now.
Show me now.
Bye-bye.
Say bye.
Bye.
Look at them now. Thank you very much.